This is Forever Collector, and we are doing Collectors Anonymous. Today, we have a huge guest. His name is David, or we know him better as Brown Eyes Yellow Dragon. How you doing, brother?
Good. How are you, Carlos?
I'm doing very well. It's good to get you on the podcast, finally. Been very excited about this feature. This guy is a huge, huge collector. He's probably one of the biggest slab collectors I get to call a friend. And he probably has more impressive cards in his collection than I do in my boxes. So I'll just be honest right there.
No.
But yeah.
Mighty,
I'm curious.
Nice of you, man. No, you have both nice cards and sealed collections.
Thank you.
In my opinion.
Thank you. I'm very proud of sealed collections. I like boxes. I like packs. I like blisters. I like all different kinds of like unique products that go within each set. And like there's some like really crazy weird third party blisters and stuff too that are really interesting that I like to collect as well. But yeah, this is about you, brother. So how'd you get into collecting?
Well, I started, you know, like everyone else. But like my first set was Legendary Collection because I really, really just aesthetically liked the reverses. You know?
Right.
And they were relatively, the entry level was really cheap for all of us, right?
Right.
Like the PSA 10s were going for like $100, bro.
Mm-hmm.
Like Nidoking 100, Alakazam 200. So it was like a nice entry level for me to start into Wizard of the Coast, which was considered still vintage, right?
Right.
And then after that LC reverse, I dived into like Neo Discovery, Neo Genesis. So I started to explore more through after LC. But I always had the goal of like finishing LC, which unfortunately I wasn't able to do. I finished the holo set, but I couldn't finish the
which
reverse.
Is
it's very tough.
It's a feat in itself, brother, so don't beat yourself up too bad. The holo collection is probably even harder to finish than the reverse holo collection just because there's certain cards that have less than 20 or 10 pop in PSA 10.
Yeah.
So it's I've swung a few times at Dark Blastoise and they all came back nines. It was very, very sad.
Yeah. I'm sure those cards were extremely minty too. But yeah, that's a very, very low pop card that you mentioned.
Definitely, bro. So that's cool. Legendary Collections. I really like the set personally. And back when I first got into it too, it was extremely, extremely cheap stuff. The packs.
Mm-hmm.
I really liked the packs because since it was the first set to include reverse holos, you always got a reverse holo, mm-hmm. So you never lost. You always had a chance at that big card or those big cards that you want, no matter what.
Absolutely.
And that's like that's Absolutely. A beautiful thing in itself, you know what I'm saying? And that's why I like Expedition and Aquapolis and Skyridge as well, because you can still pull a reverse holo Crystal Charizard, which is really amazing, or Crystal Celebi reverse holo, which is like one of my favorites, actually. And so I think all those very first WotC sets that have the reverse holos are just amazing, amazing.
Absolutely, my brother. Yeah, those are like great cards that you just mentioned, like the reverse Skyridge Charizard, reverse Skyridge Celebi. Those
mm-hmm.
are like extremely, extremely thought upon cards to this day. So,
yep.
Yeah. Yeah, it was a nice little LC was like the intro, like you said, of the reverse foil.
Yep.
And yeah, that was a nice entry level for me to get into the hobby. Yeah.
That's cool, man. That's cool. I really like to see how you went from that to owning some of the biggest cards in this hobby. And so that's, you know, entry level doesn't quite say it. You moved very quickly and very rapidly into the higher tiers of these rare cards that you can't even find in packs. So tell us something about those. What do you like to collect that doesn't come in a pack?
I'm a typical trophy whore. I like the trophy cards.
Don't we all?
Don't we all? Yeah, rarity scarcity, that's the name of the game. And I was relatively introduced to that early through fellow peers If I can name one peer, I would say AC Pokemart. He is one of the biggest collectors in the hobby. He owns a PSA 9 Illustrator.
Yeah.
So, and
yeah,
that's not a small card, right?
Yep, yeah. That's a really wild card.
Yeah, and I would like to give him a huge shout out, and he helped me out a lot into, like, you know, like, kind of go get out of the set cards and, like, truly get into those, like, scarcity and rarity card, like, Master Scroll, Master's Key, Trophy Kangaskhan, University Magic card, all that good stuff. So
just dropping bombs on us. For those who don't know, those are some of, like, the rare cards that were either won from a tournament or they were won from a competition of some kind. And there was only so many copies ever produced for that specific card. And so it makes them highly, highly desirable and valuable, of course. So that's really cool.
Thank you. Sorry about that. That was my dog.
Grab her. Let's see this beautiful pooch.
No, she just went out. She just went to their thing. So, yeah. Sorry about that, guy.
No,
yeah,
no worries.
But yeah, but obviously, I'm still a huge fan of set cards. You know, like Neo Revelation. Those are like classic sets. You know what I mean? And Fossil Jungle. Even though they were mass printed, like for example, Jungle, it's extreme. They're PSA 10 pops are still very low to this day, at least in
my opinion. It's crazy, and it's I think it attributes to the very early, you know, Wizards of the Coast that was producing a new card for a new company, and they weren't, you know, assuring that every single part was quality. And it's really interesting actually to see like the Japanese side production of Pokemon, which is like immaculate. Like there's like you can almost guarantee a 10 out of packs in Japanese, but like in English and especially in the WotC, early WotC area, oh dude, it was in errors left and right, miscuts left and right, misprints left and right. Oh, it was really, I mean, like from packs to boxes to cards, like it was crazy. Like the black triangles on packs are on base, like that was crazy. Like they were like, oh yeah, we printed too much first edition, let's just cover it up with a black triangle, no big deal.
Absolutely. And you, for example, Carlos, you speak for experience, right? Because you opened a lot of packs yourself back in the day, and
yeah
you have a hands-on experience, right?
I'm definitely, I gotta say, I've been one of the luckier ones, because most of my cards that I've pulled have been 10s, and they came back 10s. And there's That's only crazy. Been a few cards that, you know, haven't been, but I mean, I pulled the Crystal Charizard, I pulled the Corrected Blaine's Charizard, I've pulled Shining Steelix from Neo Destiny, I've pulled Shining Magikarp from Neo Destiny, and that first edition, or from Neo Revelation, excuse me, first edition, and that came back a 10 as well. There's only been like a few cards that didn't get a 10. But yeah, definitely been lucky, and I've definitely been burned too. I pulled the first edition Korean Charizard and it got a 9, and there was a manufacturer, a mark on it from the manufacturer. I have like the live video, cause it was a box break.
Oh, nice.
Yep.
Crazy.
But it was crazy because, like, in the video, as you open up the pack, you can see the little mark there. It's weird. So it's got a PSA 9 MK.
MK. Oh, mark.
Yeah,
oh,
that's cool. What MK, actually, that's what that qualifier means, yeah.
Okay, cool. Yeah, yep. Personally, I like those marks. You know, like PSA 9 OC?
Yep. Like, those are cool. Definitely. I have a friend who collects a lot of that, too. Yep. Mm-hmm. And it's really interesting because a lot of these sets, you know, they were so young as a company and they weren't worried about, you know, blade sharpness constantly. And so you're always seeing like the paint like chip in the corner and or get nicked in the corner. And so it's heartbreaking. But at the same time, when you get a 10, it feels that much better. It really, really does.
Absolutely.
When you pull a card, that's an amazing feeling.
Yep, no denial.
But when you send it to PSA and get back the 10 on it, oh my gosh, man, it is
10.
It is like throwing a perfect boomerang from one hand to the other. You're like, pow, look at that.
No, I completely agree with you. And I've only been privileged to experience a few times. But like you said, when you get that 10, it's memorable. You won't ever forget it.
Oh, definitely, yeah. Definitely. And that's like what I like the most about Pokemon. That's like what got me really bad as a kid. I would mow lawns day in and day out to get packs. I grew up a little bit poor, so that's how I got my packs. You know, I was working hard, or I was, you know, doing things for others to get, you know, coins here and there so I could go get some Pokemon.
Damn, yep. That's crazy, man.
Yep.
Wow.
But now, and it was really cool because, I don't know, when I got back into it, I went right back to the sets that I couldn't afford as a kid, and just I was buying boxes and packs and just opening all to the mouth, dude. Like, didn't care. Wow. Yeah, like every single pack. I wasn't even videotaping it, dude. It was so early, bro. I never even had that thought, and I was like pulling holo Articunos, Moltres, Zapdoses, Dragonites, Snorlax, fucking Vaporeon, wow, and Jolteon. Yeah, I was pulling all kinds of crazy shit. And I never filmed it. it took quite a minute for me to, you know, realize, hey, I should probably just be filming this, like document it for fun. And then that's how Forever Collector was born, because I just was like, oh, this is fun. I wonder if somebody else wants to watch this.
Yeah, everyone's doing it right now, right? Like, oh, yeah. Revolution. Yep. And like, Logan Paul, you know, and like everybody's just joining in on this pack opening movement. And now we're gonna have November 15th with Steve Aoki.
Yep, that's actually a pretty crazy event. If you want to talk about that a little bit, it's pretty interesting. What do you think about it?
Oh man, I mean, I don't know anything about it. I'm just like on the third viewer side. I just heard about it through Instagram, and I mean, I don't know. Do you think it will push up another layer of hype? I don't know. It's already so high in terms of my subjective view.
Right.
But if it can get more. What do you think?
I think sky's the limit, to be completely honest. Because, there's more and more people that have similar situations to us where we couldn't get the packs as a kid one way or another. And now we can. It doesn't matter. Money isn't a thing when you're wanting to, you know, relive your childhood memory. And so I think that's where a lot of people are at. They're like, oh, fuck it. We have a really good income or whatever the case may be. Let's get back into something that we missed out as a kid.
Right. So they're going to open a first edition base booster box. Whose box is it? Do you know?
I'm pretty sure it's Gary's boxes.
Cool.
Yep.
And we're gonna open it live.
Yeah. I think it's all gonna be on like Steve Aoki's page, I believe. But yeah, it's like it was really interesting. I thought it was pretty cool. If for the viewers who don't know, there's this big event going on with Gary from Pawn Stars. I'm sure you guys know who he is. Super, super Aoki. Famous from trying to pawn his Charizards to Rick Harrison and the pawn guys. So it was really cool to see that episode and to like see that there was somebody out there who like was just been hoarding this stuff. And I have seen some pictures of his collections, and he has boxes for days. He really does. So I mean, that's just my assumption. I really don't know. I'm just as in the dark as you, because I'm not somebody that, you know, was participating in it. I wish I was. I would definitely love to be participating in that in the future for sure. But yeah, this time I wasn't for sure.
Yeah. Well, we'll see. I'm excited for that opening, and you know, there's only so many of those first edition base booster boxes, right, in the world.
Yep. I think they're breaking a couple of unlimiteds as well on top of it. So, like, it was like three boxes maybe, or four boxes. And that's what I really like to see as well, because more boxes get permanently taken off the market. And that's it. And so I look at my boxes and I'm just like, oh, feel so much better. I love being able to hold on to things. I like keeping things sealed as much as I like keeping or ripping them open. And a lot of my boxes have always stayed sealed. I own a few of my most favorite sets and I've never opened them. So.
Wow. And that's a difficult thing to do, like to keep stuff sealed. And,
yeah.
The rewards are to keep it sealed is quite rewarding.
Right. Yep.
So yeah, I understand both sides. So yeah, man. Pokemon, it keeps getting bigger and stronger. And I know that there were like a traces, like retracing of unlimited base Zards and stuff. Like, I'm sorry, unlimited PSA 9.
Yep.
Whether it will be the Zards, you know, the trios. I remember they were retracing a bit and people were freaking out. But at the end of the day, it's just unlimited base. If you pay attention to other sets like Neo Genesis, like Lugia, first set.
Lugia, I don't think very many people saw that coming. Holy shit. I'm sorry for the viewers and your youngsters watching, but that was a crazy left fielder. I was selling Lugias that I was getting for free for $1,000. That's insane.
Wow.
And they were beat up, fives and sixes.
Wow. Yeah. Well, a lot of people have suddenly, you know, even the unlimited base, they're kind of going down or like retracing. There's a Neo Genesis, Lugia, PSA 9 even. They went from 2 to 5,000 in a matter of weeks. And I'm just like, wow. And PSA 10, according to the grapevine, Gary got an offer of 100K for the PSA 10 and he declined.
That's crazy.
I don't know what to say, man. I really don't know what to say. Apparently, I have the privilege of living in California and I get to meet a lot of local collectors. Like I live right next to Soulpoke, who's been in the hobby since 2015, you know, like all these like big collectors that we hear today and other collectors like Professor Oak Cali, who is a big Shadows Catalyst collector. They all live in Southern California, so I have the privilege to be exposed to that. And they tell me all this insider information, you know, because you know, to them it's just like a private conversation like you and I are having.
Right. Except this is going to be aired on the internet.
So
yeah, dude, that's cool, man. And I did notice that when I went out to LA to come visit was that the community there is just so much crazier and there's so much more people involved. Here in little bitty Minnesota, there's, you know, very, very few TCG stores in general, and there's an even smaller Pokemon collector community. And so over here, you know, it's the 5 to 10 guys that do it, and we all know each other. And over in California, in LA especially, like you could be standing next to one of the biggest collections, you wouldn't even know it, and I think that's pretty cool.
And I experienced that myself firsthand. Like when I live right by Frankincense, which I know you have been to yourself.
Oh, I love that place. I wanna do something like that here someday. That's it was amazing. Absolutely. It was amazing. Shout out to Frankincense, yo. You got a good thing going.
Yeah, for those who don't know, what Frankincense are, it's like a giant swap meet, right?
And professional as fuck too.
You know, vendors in terms.
Yep, not in some field or nothing. I've been to a few swap meets and flea markets that were, you know, all done at a farm or some, you know, dirt patch, you know, and it wasn't very well put together, and so. Frankincense is like crazy. They have some of the craziest memorabilia in there that you'll ever see. And like, that's like personal collection, I believe, of Frank or whoever actually owns that place, right? Like they have like every single McDonald's NASCAR racing suit or whatever signed by like a ton of the racers. It's crazy.
Yeah. For sure. And that place is like it's like the best place for collectors to either sell or buy.
Yep.
Whether they are into Funkos, like memorabilia, or you know, obviously for us, Pokemon cards.
Yep.
Right? Yeah.
Big time Yu-Gi-Oh sellers and buyers there. Big time action figures, like those super super expensive high quality resin statues that are like hand painted and are one of 25 and crazy shit. Yeah. There's anything you can imagine, you can find it in there. I love that place, and it was really cool to meet Paz Joker Games. We sat, me and Danny sat at that booth for a while, and it was a lot of fun. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I love those cats over there. Shout out Paz Joker.
Absolutely, man. Yeah. I remember when he started out as Yu-Gi-Oh, and then you know, he saw the opportunities in Pokemon, and then he bought some cards here and there and graded, you know, more Charizards, and he's one of us.
right Yeah, that's definitely true. It's definitely true. There's I feel like there's a bit of a need to sell just to pay for the addiction, you know what I'm saying? You got to just be able to keep it going a little bit.
Oh, it's true.
it's very fun, but it gets expensive quick. And so, you know, a lot of, like myself, the only reason why I started selling was because I needed to, so I could perpetuate itself a little bit. I was dumping tens of thousands of dollars, you know, every couple of weeks into this and just having fun at that point. You know, I wasn't even being business oriented or investing in like specific cards and stuff. I was just going after the stuff that I didn't get to have as a kid, and I spent a lot of money doing it, and it was a lot of fun. And after that, I was like, all right, let's reel it back a little bit and figure out how to, you know, get rid of the stuff I don't want so I can buy the stuff that I do want. And that's how it started.
Absolutely, man. Yeah. For me too. I was just like, for me, there were certain cards that you couldn't even find on eBay or even Yahoo Auctions. Or
mm-hmm.
The term acquisitions come into mind for me, in that no matter how much money you had, or, you know, on Instagram, they always write, or Instagram or E4, which is a forum on, it's a website for a lot of Pokemon collectors. They write in the buy section, willing to offer $4,500 for this card or $5,000 for this card. Sometimes, you know, there are cards so rare, it's hard to just get them. And it's like money is not enough, which is really surprising because, like, you know, like...
You would think if you have enough money, you could buy it, right? Money,
right?
Yeah, yep. Definitely. And it's crazy. You have to, like, know somebody and they have to like you on top of it, right? So I always thought that was, like, cool to make sure that we were, you know, getting friends that were able to, you know, find product like that, because it doesn't really matter what kind of money you have. There's certain people with certain cards that are like, I don't give a hell what you got, bro. Like if I like you, maybe I'll sell it to you. That's about as far as you get with these people. I think it's really cool because, you know, a lot of other things do have a price on it, and if you hit it, they will sell it to you. But I've legitimately offered three, four times the market on certain items, and they're like, big middle finger, bud. So it's, you know, it doesn't matter what you have, you know, and you just, that's what I like about it too, is that there's like this crazy, you know, super, super rare side of it, but it doesn't take money just to get there, or only money to get there. It takes a good personality, a kind heart, and a few good friends.
Yeah, absolutely, man. Like, obviously money, we can't deny it helps, right? Like, the more money you offer,
sure,
it's not
going to
hurt your position. But in terms of like that, finding the seller, finding that person who's willing to sell or even has that car that you're looking for, it definitely comes with the relationship and friendship / you know, connection that you meet through this hobby.
You meet
all sorts of people through this hobby. Yeah.
Right, exactly. And so, definitely. I was curious though, would you I have some stuff here that you want to open up something? We were talking about opening up stuff.
Oh yeah, I'm always down for that, man.
All right, Let me go get. I have a specific product that I wanted to buy, or to open up.
All right.
1 second. All
right. Done.
All right, guys, I'm excited here. I'm gonna quick switch you over to this other camera so you guys can get a good view of that. I think that's gonna work right there. Can you see that, David?
Oh, snap.
Like right here. So you can see that this whole thing right here. All right.
Yep.
All right. So this is a Dark Rye premium box. It was made for Diamond and Pearl. It was helping introduce Diamond and Pearl era, but it has a Crystal Guardians and Dragon Frontiers booster packs in it. So let's open it up and see what we got inside, boys. This is I love opening a product so much. And you know what's funny? The only reason why I'm opening this, and this is one of these rare products made by Pokemon themselves. So this isn't actually a third party produced product. I have three of these, so that's why I don't really mind opening it up right now.
Yeah.
This is the first time we're gonna do it really nice for this podcast. I wanted it to be a good episode, so we're going to have some fun here. I don't care. No more. This box is no more. I want to get this giant card out very nice and chill, though, because I like these giant cards. Woo! All right. Sorry about that. I'm going to try to position. I had bumped the mic. Sorry about that. So, what we're opening right now is a Darkrai premium box for the viewers who cannot see, can only listen. And we're having some fun doing it because it's always good to have some fun while you're hanging out with your friends. So, here comes the crazy part. Which one do we do first? Crystal Guardians?
Yes.
All right, we'll do Crystal Guardians first. Save the big boy for last.
I love Crystal Guardians. I hope you get the Mew.
Oh, bud, that'd be so nice if I get the Mew. Ooh, we have beautiful cards in the back. We're not going to do no card trick because we don't care about that. We're just trying to care about getting the cards out safely. We have a Krabby. Diglett. Bulbasaur. Ooh. We got the War Turtle. Okay. And non-holo Pelipper. We got the War Turtle, though. We got the War Turtle. All right.
You got the trio.
Oh, did I?
You got Bulbasaur, Charmander, and War Turtle.
Here we go for the second one. Dragon Frontiers. Come on, baby. Come on. Let's get some crazy. Come on, baby. Come on.
Charizard, baby.
Ladyba. Nidoran. Elekid, Ralts, Ekans, we have a Trapinch reverse holo, and, a non-holo Arbok.
Oh, I thought you got crazy. A Gyarados. I was about to...
That's sad. We pulled nothing out of that. And it's got like a holo misprint at the top. What's in this thing? There's nothing good in here. Some of these deck boxes have a pack inside as well. So we got two duds. Sat, womp womp. We need a button for that. Womp womp womp.
It's all good. I've never seen those packs open like this, so it's pretty
cool. Yeah. Well, I'm glad you enjoyed it, brother. I definitely like these big cards. These big cards are crazy cool. Not too bad either. So, imagine trying to assure the quality on these fucking things, huh? These oversized cards. Oh my goodness, it'd be so ridiculously hard to keep up with that.
Pain in the ass.
Yeah, definitely, yeah, definitely. Sure. All right, let's get back to our chat here. That's all right. Here we go. Can you hear me? Everything's good?
Yep. All right,
let me clean up this little mess here. So, yeah, brother, what are you chasing right now? Or are you just hanging out now because you got some pretty big cards in today?
Yeah, I mean, I'm always like,
excuse me.
Small things I'm looking for, like, you know, Mew Victory Orb and Super Secret Battle Mewtwo. Those kind of good, like, upper tier cards. But in terms of, like, my contentment, I'm pretty good. I don't think I'll be as intensive as I was, if that makes sense. I will be always be involved with the community, Pokemon community, and that, like, I'll always be focused on new sets and,
right,
you know, try to get those, you know, the Champions Pass, Vivid Voltage, all those good stuff. And but, like, in terms of, like, going on eBay, you know, seeing market prices or last sold, I'll be less intensive in that. Yeah, I'm pretty, other than those cards that I mentioned, I'm pretty happy with my current position. And I strongly believe that the hobby will outprice me, even, you know, someone who started, you know, 2 or 3 years ago. Yep. Like, there will be even bigger pockets than you and I can think of. And
oh, we 100%. Won't be outpriced.
Yeah. So, and I'm completely okay with that. Yeah, I'm humbled by that. Yeah.
I think that's important to always remember, not just in Pokemon, but in everything. There's always somebody who's going to be better than you or have more than you. And so that's important to always try not to, like, compare yourself. But in terms of being priced out, I think we have a while for that to happen, just because we did get in so early and we have amassed a crazy, crazy collection. So if at any time we need to liquidate to make a purchase for something else that we're looking for, it's not that hard. And so I don't think we're going to be priced out for a long time if we ever are. Because, you know, who knows, by then we might be crazy, crazy more than what we are now. You know, who knows? 5 years from now, we could be more addicted than we are now, right? It could go the other way. We could be over here, you know, downgrading to a smaller house so I can buy a nice, you know, vault room for my Pokemon.
No, that's really interesting that you say that. For me, like, if I could name a specific card, like Crystal Charizard, Skyridge, PSA 10, I think I'm definitely outpriced. You know, like, I don't think I can pay, like, I think it's like 25K PSA 10. I don't think I can, like, easily drop that as compared to its predecessor prices, you know?
Definitely. Yeah. But you own two. So, I mean, like, you're not priced out of much there, bud. I'm just being honest. Definitely. Definitely. You're not, you know, when you already own one or two or something, I don't think you can be priced out of that item. You have it. You're done. Definitely.
Ugh. No, I feel you. Sorry about that. My internet connection is kind of being funky, but let me fix this real quick.
That's all right. Okay. That's all right. No worries at all.
All right.
Should be good.
But yeah. What about you? What are your goals? What are next for you? I feel like you are pretty content yourself, no?
Yes, I am looking. I am looking for something. If anybody wants to help me, you know, try to find it, and somebody who wants to trade for it, I'm.
Yeah, it's hard to. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. I'm definitely looking for the phone card birds. I really, really want the phone card birds. Like, that's like one trio set that I would easily trade a lot of stuff for. So, you know, anybody out there, if you're listening to this and you have the trio phone cards, hit your boy up. Let's see what we can work out.
I don't know the trio people, but I know some people like Poke Emperor and Pokemon Radar, which I know you know.
Yeah. I know who both of them are. But they only own one of them or two of them. I want to buy all three of them for one person. Preferably sequential too, because there's two or three sets that are PSA 10 sequential, if you didn't know that.
Oh, I didn't know that at all. And those cards, you want them in PSA 10? They're like super expensive, aren't they?
Oh, yeah. And they're super, super rare. I don't know. I really, really like the art for one. And I also think it's really cool that it was an actual phone card that you were able to like punch in, right? That's pretty cool.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, those are definitely grails that I personally would love to observe.
I mean, like, if we're, you know, like, the absolute grail for me is definitely the Super Secret Battle Trophy cards. Mewtwo's my favorite Pokemon as well, so him being on those trophy cards just makes it, like, that much cooler and, like, that much more desirable, in my opinion.
Absolutely, yeah. I believe Mewtwo was my last first edition base PSA 10 card that I was able to acquire before the Logan Paul explosion. Yeah. And I'm happy that was the card that I was able to acquire, even though I wish, you know, we all want to get as many PSA 10s as possible. But for me, I'm happy that I was able to at least acquire Mewtwo because, you know, that's our childhood favorite Pokemon. You know, that's our first movie and it has a lot of nostalgia to it.
Yeah.
And that's the card that Gary V mixed reviews about him, but at the end of the day, that was the card that he first publicized that, all right, I'm into Pokemon, you know?
Yeah.
People have told me that he's been into Pokemon since like years, but that was that first card. He was like, yep, I bought that card. Here you go. I'm into Pokemon. So I'm happy to have acquired Mewtwo, and hopefully I get to at least witness another SSB Super Secret Battle Mewtwo on auction one day.
Yeah, that'll be a tough one because I know myself and a few other people will be taking on second mortgages. Not a problem. But yeah, definitely. What else are you into? I know that you're into a very little bit of sealed product. You own some of the Mario and Luigi sealed boxes.
I bought from you. I loved it. Thank you.
Not a problem. Thank you for not a problem. I'm glad you love it, brother. I really enjoyed them boxes as well. I love the crossovers with the Poncho Pikachu. It was very, very cool and very new, you know what I'm saying, to do with Pokemon. And they did a lot of crossovers. I don't think a lot of the other stuff was official by Pokemon, but like they did Pikapool and they did a lot of other cool stuff with Pikachu as well, which I thought was like really cool. But as far as like the Poncho Pikachus, there was like Team Skull Grunt, the Poncho Gyarados and Magikarp, the Rayquazas, the Charizards, and then there's like a few other ones. Can't remember off the top of my head, but those I thought were super, super cool. I own some of them as well. If anybody wants to see them in the future, I'll post them for sure. I don't know. I'm a huge fan of those boxes. They were sold by the Pokemon Center, and they were like a store exclusive product. So they were only sold in Japan. And they were only sold for a very short period of time or while supplies lasted, I think, which didn't last very long for some of these ones. But yeah, the Mario and Luigi's like huge right now. Huge. I saw an opened one with all the contents in it, but it was open.
Uh-huh.
He sold it for $1,200 by itself, just the Mario.
Wow. That's crazy.
And he wanted $1,800 for the Luigi.
He just $1,800 for the Luigi.
Yeah, but that one was sealed. Open? No, it was sealed.
Oh, that one was sealed.
Yep, that one was sealed. Definitely.
Wow.
Yep.
I bought both of them, Luigi and Mario, open and on eBay for $1,700 back like 2 months ago, and then
Yep.
I sent them to PSA, and we'll see how it goes.
Oh
Yeah.
man, fingers crossed for you.
Yeah, thank you,
I have
thank
a few of
you.
the I have like the Gyarados and the Magikarp, Poncho, Pikachu, and a 10, as well as the sealed
Yeah.
box.
Oh,
I think
nice,
it's really
nice.
cool having like some of the sets of PSA 10 to go with like the sealed product. And that's what me and my other friend we were really talking about. It's like me, I'm just like all over the place. Like I want everything to do with one set. I want a master set. I want complete PSA 10 holo set or secret rare within that set. And then I want all the blisters. I want the box. I want all the other products that had those packs in it. I want the store displays. I want I have even like this Deoxys here. I'm gonna grab it 1 second. This Deoxys poster I got, I really like, but I got this as well. Got it tangled up a little bit here. Hold on. I know you guys can see me. Well, whatever. I just want to show you. So this thing
No, no way.
it would like hang in the store. I have two of them. But yeah, they're a little bit tangled up. So
You don't
like
see those
this would just
anymore,
like
that's for
hang in
sure.
the store like this from the ceiling with the theme decks. So each of the
Damn.
things hanging down are the theme decks.
Damn.
And then this side is the Rayquaza, and then this side's Deoxys.
Deoxys, yeah, for sure.
Oh man, I love like all these like weird products that these sets came out with for each one, right? That Pokemon was like, oh yeah, let's make a cool little box of this or a collector's box of that. Like, I own these as well.
Wow.
Both sealed.
Wow.
Super mint.
That's the thing, Carlos. I cannot get into I cannot get into sealed products at this point of the hobby because they're just too difficult to acquire.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yeah, and it's getting harder and harder to acquire legit product as well. So I can definitely feel why you're not so much tipping your feet in yet. For me though, I don't know. It's having the card in a PSA 10 is like really, really cool. But having the box for it, I can just like pull it at any time I want. Like let's say I'm 80 years old and I just want to open this shit and pull a card, I can pretty much do that, especially with the WotC sets.
Absolutely, man, and that's definitely a position that I'm sure a lot of people want to be in,
Oh,
and
definitely.
that is yeah, it's an impressive I guess direction. In either way, so whether you go slab or you go steel, I think it's applied in either way. Yeah.
Yeah. I agree with that. And it's really interesting 'cause I think they're both very impressive in their own respective. And so that's why I'm all over the place. I think there's so much cool stuff and like there's so many different products and there's a lot to learn. Like coming into this hobby, there's so much to learn. It's like almost like learning another language. When
Oh,
people
for
hear
sure.
me talk about Pokemon or talk about a price of a Pokemon or something that I'm trying to acquire, I might as well
Yeah.
be speaking Mandarin? And so
Absolutely.
it's really cool that when I got into it, that there was this community that talked the same language as I did. And I ran with it, and I love it. I've loved every second of it. So I love being in the community. It's a lot of people, you know, are, you know, saying lately it's a little bit too much with the prices and stuff like that. But I think that also gives the opportunity to the real members of the community to shine. I think it gives them, I think it gives other small time collectors an opportunity to become bigger. Because there's always a collection out there to be purchased that can be life-changing money. And I think that self-motivation is a part of that. You know, if you really want to be successful in something, you have to put 100% into it. And I think that, you know, more people should be trying to do that instead of just being upset that, you know, prices are the way they are or that there's certain influencers in the community now. I think we should embrace them because education is going to be the longest lasting aspect of Pokemon. Not us, not our money. It's the education and the knowledge.
Absolutely, man. I couldn't agree more with that statement. And there will always be, you know, we spoke in earlier and privately, there will always be haters. There will always be people kind of put you down in terms of reaching certain goals. But at the end of the day, once you reach it, and it's our goal, not anyone else's goal.
Right. And that's with anything, you know. And I think there's a lot of people, you know, who can be upset with whatever is in their lives or, you know, whatever the case may be. And I'm here just to share my experience and my side of it. And that's just what I want to do is share the love I have for Pokemon with other people, because I think it's a very, very healthy way to express who you are. And collecting in general, not just collecting Pokemon. I think collecting in general is a very, very good way to express yourself. I think it's a very, very healthy way to express yourself. I think that when you are collecting, you're staying out of trouble 100%. And I also think that it's something that it's cool to pass on to your children. And that's probably the biggest connection that any collector and their collection can make, is to be able to pass it down. And I think that one day, because my kids right now, they love Pokemon. They are just as big as collectors as I am. And hopefully their kids are like that and their kids are like that. So when I'm 90 years old, I can be like, listen here, you little guy, let's get this going. I've had some Charizards that are older than your parents, bro. Let's go.
Wow, that's amazing. Everything. I agree with you, man. It definitely, I see the longevity of Pokemon, and I don't see influencers or anyone like, you know, Logan Paul getting into hobby as a negative thing. I think it's more like stating the obvious.
Yeah. Right.
And it's like, it's long overdue that Pokemon has been such iconic collectible / you know, it's a journey, right? You know, like, there's never been a hobby where you have to search for different cards, whereas like, whether it's Play Promo, Gold Star, Espeon, or Umbreon, those are extremely difficult to find.
And they're not even hollows. They're not even a holographic, and they're some of the most sought-after Gold Stars ever in English. And in Japanese, but the Japanese versions are holographic. But that what's crazy is that in English, they were found in a pack, but in Japanese, you had to earn 35,000 player points within the tournaments. And I think the seasons were only like 6 or 7 months long. So each player that earned one of those had to go to like almost every single tournament, and they had to place a certain number to even get to that point. And like 35,000 is insane number of tournaments, insane amount of time and effort put into it. And I think 100% they deserve that. And I think the reason I agree 100% with the reason why they are, you know, $50,000 plus now. Like, they're crazy numbers. When I was first joining the community, they were like only 10,000, 15,000. And back then I was just too young to like even want to like get after that, because I was like, oh, I'm still going after Jungle and Fossil and Base, because I never could afford that as a kid, you know? And a year later, it jumped to 20, 30,000. And then now they're above 50,000. You can't find them for less. It's crazy.
Yep.
And I like a lot of those cards. A lot of those cards, I think, in Japanese, where you had to earn enough points, like the Flareon Gold Star, the Celebi that you have. You own that one. And then what else? There was a few other ones I can't even remember.
The Mew EX Play promo. That was another
one. Yep, the Mew EX Play promo. And then, Christ.
Jolteon.
Oh, Shining Magikarp. I love that one. I think it was 800 points. Uh-huh. And that was the fan club. 500
points? 500
points. Okay, so that was like nothing. Yeah. imagine having to be able to go get 500 points, bro.
Believe it or not, though, but the PSA 10 for that card is pop. 11.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yep.
So it's not that. Definitely. It's quite rare.
Yep. It is. But it's because the tournaments over there weren't popping as much as they were, and so in the beginning, like with the Super Secret Battle from like 96 to 2001, it was on fire in Japan. Then it kind of died out a little bit. And that's why you saw like a lot of the Neo Revelation play promo, Neo Destiny play promo, and so on farther. There wasn't much out there. And I think, I don't want to quote the Japanese gold stars in a 10, but like those I'm sure are 10 or less.
Yeah.
Definitely. They have to be. They have to be.
Yeah, definitely the upper tier gold star evolutions are up. They're quite rare.
Yep. Yeah. And then what's the Flareon? Is it 1,300 points? I might be wrong.
I think it's 30,000.
Okay. Yeah. I'm going to check that real quick.
Yeah. Fact check.
Oh, I just smacked the mic. So yeah, brother, I think it's a really amazing thing that, you can go pretty much anywhere, into this country and get what you're looking for in Pokemon. There's so much variety here in the States. It's crazy how many collections you can come up on just by driving around, or, you know, trying to like search Craigslist and all the social media sites. There's so much product out there. There's so much product in like every country as well, like in Mexico, all the Spanish produced stuff. That was super, super sought after, and they couldn't keep that stuff on the shelves over in certain parts of Europe and in Australia. That a lot of that stuff was broke, and that's why all that red label stuff is crazy rare. There's I don't want to throw an exact number out there, but I'd say it's less than like 40 or 50 for Red Logo Jungle and Red Logo Fossil. It's crazy. Damn. It's got to be nothing, cuz I've been in the community for almost 3 years and I've come across only a few, and that were for sale at least. So, I mean, that should say something, because a lot of people want to move a lot of product at certain times. So I would have seen it a lot more for sale if it was more widely available. I can go find an unlimited fossil box or unlimited rocket box any day of the week. I could buy 10 of them right now on the market if I wanted to. But I could buy one red logo on the market.
Damn.
Maybe. Damn. And that might not even be on the market per se. It goes back into, oh, I'm cool with that person, so he might sell it to me if I give him the right number. But then again, it's just because he's cool with me that I would, you know, the right number even exists.
Mm-hmm. It's true. And you the red logo is on the jungle set that you were mentioning. Oh man,
I have an art set of packs that are red logo jungle.
Damn.
Yep. I love them. Super, super nice pair. Or trio, excuse me.
Wow. And I remember when you and I were discussing about regarding jungle, about no symbol, and that how you think or you're saying no symbol should be more valuable than forced edition jungle. That
I
was
mean,
really
for a long
interesting
time
to
it
me.
was 100%.
Oh, really?
The populations for no symbols are a fraction of what they are for first editions, straight up.
That's true.
And
That's
back
true.
then, there wasn't as many people flooding into the community, so the education was a lot easier to spread. And so that actually being a rare form of that or version of that card, it did make it to the people who knew that more expensive than the first editions. I think at one point, the first edition Vaporeon was selling for like a $500 and PSA 10, and then the no symbol was selling for 1100, so like over double.
Wow.
Yeah,
Wow.
but I
Take me
mean,
back to those prices.
those like, yeah, right? Oh, I mean, I would have still paid that gladly, straight up. But I think right, and you saw like a little bit of a change just because you are seeing all these new people and the education can't spread as fast, so there's kind of like this little, gap in between the learning curve and people's collections. And so I think that once the education catches up to all the new people coming into the community, no symbols once again will reign supreme, just because there's so minuscule amounts of no symbol, it's not even funny. And to
Damn.
even know that that's no symbol, you actually have to open up a box and open up the packs.
Yeah.
There's no outside markings. It's just like Black Triangle. There's no outside markings at all that let you know that that's no symbol. And trust me, me and my friends, between me and two other friends, we've probably all owned like three or four cases out of the years. And we've opened up like six of them, and none of them were no symbols. Yep.
Wow.
Not one. Yeah, out of pretty much like a whole case, like of different boxes, sourced different places. Yeah, not one of them. Yeah, sad. It's super rare.
Wow.
I've seen more black triangles than I've seen no symbols. That's a fact. Yep.
Damn.
I think,
Damn.
yeah, I think no symbols are definitely super underrated right now. But I think they'll reign supreme once again. We'll get there.
If I can share my recent acquisition,
I would
it
love to, and
is
then we'll get going here. While we're on the subject
my
of
no
no
symbol.
symbols. That is a PSA
Okay.
10 Vaporeon Holo no symbol card. To get this card is astronomical numbers and rarities for trying to find it in the wild, I guess I should say. And when you do find them, they're already beat to bits. They're never ever mint. I'd say I've bought and I don't know, 10, 15, 20 no symbols, and the best I've gotten was a 9. Most of them were like 7s and 8s. And so it's definitely a thing that people should pay attention to is certain errors that were very prominent, like no symbol. No symbol is a very, very prominent error. As you can see, PSA recognizes it. That's how prominent that error is.
Damn. Yeah. I mean, there's no fucking mark on
Oh
there.
yeah, it's mint. We can see it as obviously the viewers that aren't watching, they can't see it, but from my eyes it's beautifully mint. It deserves that 10. The centering on it is just magnificent. Absolutely magnificent. And the holo is clean. Super clean. Love it. Thanks for sharing, brother.
Another one.
And he pulls out the no symbol Snorlax holo PSA 10. This is another one where the first edition counterpart just sold for over $10,000, and you're seeing this one, the no symbol. I think the fractions on the and he pulls out the first edition to compare. Yep, so you can see that the card is obviously missing a first edition symbol, and it is also missing the set symbol that would be in the bottom right picture of the card. That means that there's no symbol that indicates what set Snorlax came from. And that was a very, very short error that was never made again in the entire TCG. Jungle is the only set that ever affected from the error called no symbol. But it definitely, it looks, it's crazy. It looks crazy. It's really interesting to see it without both of the little markings on both corners, right? Like, it's just, like, naked almost.
Yes, sir. It's like the shadowless of jungle.
Yeah, definitely. It's like, you can't, once you know that, you never miss it. You know, you see it every single time. Every time. So that's what I really like about the no symbol, too. You can really train yourself pretty easily on that. Mm-hmm. But it's getting pretty late, brother. Do you want to stop and we'll have a good conversation sometime in the future, huh?
Yeah, for sure, my brother.
All right, we'll stay in touch, man. I'm excited to see where you take your collection in the future, and I hope to have you on the podcast again sometime.
All right, my brother. Thank you for having me. We'll talk soon.
All right. Have a good night.
You too.